Yes, guys, welcome back to the channel as always. So in today's video, guys, I'm going to play a video of Vitalik Buterin talking about Ethereum 2.0.
15 transactions a second is not it. Here, we're talking about potentially tens of thousands of transactions per second.
So guys, I just want to say this as well, you know, whether you're an EOS guy, an Ethereum guy, Tron, IOST, whichever blockchain you're a part of or a developer of or whatever, at the end of the day, guys, it's actually really worth watching this whole video. You know, Ethereum 2.0 actually has some pretty cool features. And I think, you know, as a cryptocurrency community as a whole, you know, if Ethereum 2.0 succeeds, we all succeed. You know, in my personal opinion, I don't see any tribalism. You know, I think that, you know, EOS and Ethereum can work absolutely incredibly together. And I think it's like, you know, the tide raises all ships. You know, I think if cryptocurrency as a whole is going to succeed, we need things like Ethereum to succeed. You know, if Ethereum 2.0 fails and it's really bad, it's not going to be good for anybody in the space, even Bitcoin. So, you know, at the end of the day, guys, I highly recommend watching this whole video. There are some really interesting things in it. And full disclosure, I do hold Ethereum tokens. But yes, guys, without further ado, enjoy the video. Have a good day. Cheers. Bye.
So, to get right into it, first of all, you know, what is Ethereum 2.0, right? So some of you might have seen the news that Nimbus, a team that's part of the Status Project, just released a test network for Ethereum 2.0. So, you know, what exactly is this, right? So the Ethereum project started at the beginning of 2014. It launched in 2015, and since then, it's had some changes, and so there was the Homestead hard fork, there was the Spurious Dragon upgrade, the Byzantium and Constantinople upgrades, and there is going to be the Istanbul upgrade soon enough. But Ethereum 2.0 is something that's much more substantial than many of these, right? So, since the Ethereum project began, there's always been this expectation that making blockchain consensus work in a way that's more efficient than proof of work and making blockchains more scalable than they are right now is kind of part of what people expected as being Ethereum, right? So proof of stake and sharding have been a part of the roadmap that we've been talking about since 2014. It's something that we've been actively researching for several years. We've gone through many protocols, many iterations, and these proof of stake and sharding are still part of the roadmap today, right? But the difference is that, unlike in 2014, now proof of stake and sharding are well on the path to actually arriving. Architecture, right? So the architecture of Ethereum 2.0 looks roughly as follows. At the center of the Ethereum 2.0 system, there is what we call the beacon chain. And the purpose of the beacon chain is essentially to manage the consensus. So the beacon chain stores information about the active proof of stake validators in the system, what messages they have sent. It acts as this kind of central chain that the shard chains, which actually hold data, plug into. And it is the kind of thing that the consensus itself kind of revolves around. The beacon chain has a connection to the existing Ethereum 1.0 chain. So it is a new chain, but this is not a separate ecosystem. This is an extension to the existing Ethereum chain and ecosystem. And the bridge basically allows you to take Ether and potentially other assets that you have inside of the existing Ethereum 1.0 network and move them through the beacon chain into the shards and into the Ethereum 2.0 network. So if you have Ether on the Ethereum 1.0 chain and you have 32 ETH, then you can send the 32 ETH into a contract. And this, when you send the ETH into the special contract, it generates a Merkle proof. It generates a chain of cryptographic hashes that you can then include into the beacon chain to prove that you did this. And by sending the 32 ETH into a contract, what you are doing is you are registering as one of the proof of stake validators, one of the participants in the beacon chain's consensus. So in the beacon chain itself keeps track of this validator pool, this set of users that have put their own Ether in and have agreed to help kind of uphold the security of the system, and the consensus of the network runs between these validators. So this is just a brief technical overview as to how the Beacon Chain works. So time on the Beacon Chain is split into these 6-minute epochs. During each 6-minute epoch, there are 64 slots. During each slot, there is a block on the Beacon Chain. And each block gets kind of signed first by a single block proposer, and then it gets attested to, it gets kind of approved by this very large set of validators, basically 1/64 of the entire validator set. The goal of this is basically to be able to rapidly propose and rapidly agree on new blocks that are being added to the Beacon Chain. One of the interesting things that will happen in the Ethereum system is staking, right? So Ethereum is moving from a proof-of-work system to a proof-of-stake system, and part of this is just a kind of thing that happens in the background that makes the blockchain more secure, but it's also a mechanism that you can participate in, right? So if you have at least 32 ETH, you can deposit that ETH in this deposit contract. After you deposit it, you can wait a few hours, and after that, you are kind of, quote, logged in as an active validator, right? So when you're an active validator, basically, you're running a piece of software on your computer, and this piece of software is just connected to the network. That software has some cryptographic key inside of it, and you're using this cryptographic key to sign messages, basically saying which blocks in the blockchain you think are going to be correct. Validating has some rewards, so the current expectation is somewhere between 2 to 6% of the deposit value every year. If you go offline, then the rewards for going offline are lower, but it's not too punitive, right? So even if you're offline 10% of the time, you still get somewhere about 3/4 of the rewards you would have gotten if you were online the whole time. Now, this is not passive interest, right? You actually have to keep a node online. You actually have to keep verifying transactions. If your node does something wrong, you can get penalized. And the cost of running a node, the verification costs, are kind of proportional to the size of the amount of ETH that you're putting in, right? So if you put in 32 ETH, then you only need to verify currently about 25 kilobytes per second of chain data. But if you put in 320 ETH, then you have to verify 250 kilobytes per second of chain data. So this is kind of very different from what properties that a lot of other protocols have, right? In the Ethereum 2.0 protocol, like, we've been trying very hard to achieve certain kinds of properties that are difficult for other kinds of protocols to achieve, right? So, like, first of all, like, this proof of stake and sharding system, it's basically allows a blockchain to process a very high number of transactions without requiring any individual node to process many transactions themselves. And furthermore, it creates this kind of egalitarian staking mechanism where a validator with a small amount of ETH does not have kind of high fixed costs, and a validator that's staking a lot of ETH has to deal with higher costs of verifying transactions. So, I mean, there's considerable kind of technical complexity involved in making all of this work, right? And a lot of the time people ask us, well, why do we need to do this kind of this particular approach to proof of stake and sharding? Why couldn't we instead, just make a simpler proof of stake blockchain where you just require that every single validator in the network has a very powerful computer, has to process a really large number of transactions, and where the number of these nodes is much smaller. And the answer here is basically decentralization, right? So especially in any proof of work or proof of stake or any this kind of network where the consensus is controlled by this kind of economic mechanism, there's always this constant risk that the network is going to become centralized, that it's going to become this kind of concentrated by one or two pools, mining pools, staking pools, exchanges, large actors that then just end up kind of grabbing control of the system. And here, like, our goal in many ways is to try to push really hard against that, right? We're basically saying, you know, no, you do not need to have a professional, personal mining and staking farm in order to participate in securing the network. If you have only 32 ETH, then you can just do it at home. If you have anywhere up to a few hundred ETH, you might even be able to do it on your laptop. Now, if you have more, then you'll need a specialized computer. If you have many more, you'll need a very powerful server rack, right? But the goal here is that, you know, it should be possible to participate in the network kind of at all scales. And the network should be able to survive even if these kind of highly professional, centralized parts of the network just do not end up existing. So technologies that make this possible, I mean, this includes some advances in cryptography, including like BLS aggregate signatures, a technology called proof of custody, optimizations on Merkle proofs, our work on Casper, the consensus algorithm. I mean, a long time spent trying to make the protocol maximally simple, scalable, and secure. And with this goal of, you know, preserving the decentralization of the base layer, right? So, phases. So this kind of the rollout of Ethereum 2.0 is expected to come in multiple phases. And one of basically you can look at it this way, right? So right now we're here, but you know, really we're here, right? So really there's been a huge amount of work done kind of already, and what's left is essentially deployment, right? So phase zero is basically going to bring proof of stake. So this basically means that you can deposit your ETH, you can start staking, and the chain itself doesn't really have much functionality. And this is a deliberate decision, right? The goal here is basically that the chain can launch and people can try out using the chain, and the chain itself can kind of start running and operating. And it's still a very early stage, right? The goal is to basically give time for the network and for the staking mechanism itself to kind of stabilize and prove itself. Phase one, data sharding. So this basically means that the shard chains start working, except all they're doing is verifying data. They're not verifying transactions, they're not running smart contracts, they're not verifying validity of transactions. All they're doing is they're just verifying that data has actually been published. And this already is actually usable for like some very interesting protocols. I had a presentation at the Sol Ethereum meetup yesterday where I talked about something called ZK Rollup. And basically, even just phase one by itself can be used to really scale blockchain applications. Phase two, state and execution, accounts, smart contracts, and like full functionality. And phases three and beyond, basically further technical upgrades. The next thing I wanted to talk about is like what kinds of, is all of this useful, right? Like what kinds of things are we trying to accomplish with all of this? A big part of the answer comes in what Andreas talked about yesterday in the morning when he talked about this idea that at some point, blockchain technology, just in terms of its usability, is going to reach parity with traditional systems. And when that happens, then suddenly a lot of things, like instead of the question being, well, why should this be on a blockchain? In some cases, the question will be, well, why not put this on the blockchain? Definitely not in every case, but in more cases than today. Right? So if we look at the way blockchains work today, the scalability is limited to about 15 transactions per second. Block times are on average about 14 seconds. Sometimes they go above 1 minute. Privacy is, in many cases, almost non-existent. On this kind of platform, like there's not that many applications that can really effectively survive. And even if transaction fees are fairly low today, there's a lot of applications that just aren't being developed because they know that if they are the application that succeeds, then they themselves will be the ones that pushes transaction fees up to infinity until like basically their application stops being useful because their fees are too high. The goal of these improvements is to just basically on every front try to make cut down the difference, cut down this delta of usability between blockchains as they exist now and centralized systems, right? So scaling, and the goal here is to improve scalability, to increase the number of transactions that can happen on the network, and to increase it to a level that seems like it's something that you can start working with to kind of power parts of the global economy, right? 15 transactions a second is not it. Here, we're talking about potentially tens of thousands of transactions per second, and arguably that's still not enough, but it's it's a major stepping stone, and it's something that can be combined with other technology and other improvements later on, hopefully to actually allow us to get there. Now, proof of stake. Proof of stake also gives us an opportunity to kind of re-architect many aspects of the system, and particularly one of the major pieces of this is this. And of architecture that we've developed, where you have basically every block on the chain, instead of being confirmed by one additional block every 15 seconds, it gets confirmed by hundreds to thousands of messages within a few seconds. So here we're not talking about a system where, like, after you send a transaction, you have to go get a coffee before it gets confirmed. Here we're talking about transactions where you can send a transaction to a merchant, and the merchant can see and confirm that the transaction is confirmed within about the same amount of time as it takes for the merchant to process a credit card. And I personally believe that getting these differences in usability really down, and getting decentralized kind of base layer platforms to the point where they actually are powerful and kind of efficient enough that from a just user's point of view, it's something that regular people can actually work with, and it doesn't kind of impose all of these weird, unexpected costs, transaction fees, waiting time on them, then we can start seriously seeing many more blockchain applications appear. And especially in this sphere where we're not just talking about blockchain applications where you only need to have one transaction every couple of months, but we're also talking about payments and potentially all of these non-financial use cases that people are talking about as well, right? If transaction fees are at a dollar, then blockchain platforms are, the set of things that blockchain platforms are useful for is really going to be fairly limited. But if we can cut costs down much more, then we can get the costs of using these platforms down much closer to something that would be acceptable for a much larger array of industries, and that would allow us to actually test and see, what kinds of things could what kinds of places could blockchains help, if we had the means to? Because with this kind of technology, and I hope that we will have the means to. The path of development of, both Ethereum and blockchain technologies in general, is something that where we still have quite a long way to go. But it's, I think it's clear at this point that there's a lot of people working on making this happen, and there's a lot of people working on making alternative approaches to scalability happen, including layer two protocols, state channels, Plasma, Lightning networks, systems include using zero knowledge proofs for security, and many other things. And so we really can expect that within a couple of years, the scalability, usability, this all of the necessary properties of these systems are going to be much better than they are today. We as developers of technology need to make sure that when the time comes and they actually build the things that they want to build, the technology is ready to accept it. That's something that I'm confident that we can work together and actually achieve. Thank you.